Then we're called to go to a pastor's convention in Las Vegas. They all had to share a room when they got there. So when they get to the convention, one of the pastors said, since we're going to be sharing a room together, we should confess our secret sins to each other. He says, I would be glad to start. I am a notorious gambler. As soon as I leave town, for me, it's just cha-ching, cha-ching. Let those machines ring. So they thought about that for a minute, and the second pastor, he says, my secret sin is that I absolutely hate working. Anytime I get the chance, I just copy my sermon from a sermon another pastor has given, and then I don't have to work at all. And they all thought about that for a minute. Finally, the third pastor said, well, my secret sin is I'm a horrible gossip. I can't wait to get home and tell everybody about you guys. I thought that was a good place for us to start this morning as we continue our series from the book of Romans. Today we are in the first part of chapter 14 of Romans. Excuse me. This is Romans 14 verses 1 through 13. Romans 14 verses 1 through 13. And it reads, him that is weak in the faith receive ye, but not to doubtful disputations. For one believeth that he may eat all things, another who is weak eateth herbs. Let not him that eateth despise him that eateth not, and let not him which eateth not judge him that eateth. For God hath received him. Who art thou that judgest another man's servant? To his own master he standeth or falleth, yea, he shall be holden up, for God is able to make him stand. One man esteemeth one day above another esteemeth every day alike. Let every man be fully persuaded in his own mind. He that regardeth the day regardeth it unto the Lord, and he that regardeth not the day to the Lord he doth not regard it. He that eateth to the Lord, for he giveth God thanks, and he that eateth not to the Lord he eateth not and giveth God thanks. For none of us live to himself, and no man dies to himself. For whether we live unto the Lord. And whether we die unto the Lord. Whether we live therefore or die, we are the Lord's. For to this end Christ both died and rose and revived, that he might be Lord of both the living and the dead. But why dost thou judge thy brother? Or why dost thou set at naught thy brother? For we shall all stand before the judgment seat of Christ. For it is written, as I live, saith the Lord, every knee shall bow to me, and every tongue shall confess to God. So then, every one of us shall give account of himself to God. Let us not therefore judge one another any more, but judge this rather, that no man put a stumbling block or an occasion to fall in his brother's way. Now, as I begin this morning, I will start with the question, do most Christians agree on everything? Of course they don't. Half the time we can hardly get along. Sometimes we as Christians are quick to judge others and their relationship to God or the way that they live. Now, we know that there is a lot of false teaching and casual Christianity out there, and rightfully, we don't want to get taken in by that. I'm not saying we don't call sin, sin. Of course we do. But at the same time, the basis for our judgment isn't always the best one. It's easy for us to confuse our personal preferences with what the Bible teaches regarding certain issues. Martin Luther King Jr. once declared, cowardice asks the question, is it safe? Consensus asks the question, is it popular? Conscience asks the question, is it right? The Bible assigns conscience an important role in the Christian life. The Holy Spirit often works through the conscience, either to excuse or to convict us. However, this does not mean that our conscience is infallible. Some people have seared their conscience and can no longer distinguish between that what is right and what is wrong. 1 Timothy chapter 4, verses 1 and 2 address this. It says, "Now the Spirit speaketh expressly that in the latter times some shall depart from the faith, giving heed to seducing spirits and doctrines of devils, speaking lies and hypocrisy, having their conscience seared with a hot iron." Others, like those described in today's passage, suffer from a weak conscience. They feel guilty over actions that aren't even sinful to begin with. In the Christian life, our conviction should be taken seriously. Not only do we need to be sensitive to the prodding of our own conscience, it's important that we have regard for the conscience of others. Chapter 14 deals with functioning in controversy, particularly controversies within the church, within our church family. You see, even in Rome, in this early church, they had already engaged in our most favorite of Christian indoor sports, which of course is judging other Christians. Thus, the principle of acceptance of other Christians is set forth here by Paul. Christians are at different levels of spiritual maturity. They also have diverse backgrounds that affect their attitudes and their practices. We are to stop judging other Christians over non-essentials and learn to live harmoniously with them. That is what Paul is teaching here. He's teaching harmony in the church. I'll tell you guys this story. This is the British and the French. They are fighting. This is in the 1750s over Canada. Admiral Phipps, who was the commander of the British fleet, was told to anchor outside of Quebec. He was given orders to wait for the British land forces to arrive and then support them when they attacked the city. So the Navy arrives early, and as this Commander Phipps waited, he became annoyed by the statues of saints that he saw on the towers of a nearby cathedral. So he commanded his men to shoot at them with the ship's cannons. Now, nobody knows how many rounds were fired or how many statues were knocked out, but when the land forces finally arrive and the signal is given to attack, the admiral is of no help. He had used up all of his ammunition shooting at the saints. Now, that is from the Daily Bread. But unfortunately, the same can be said for many Christians today. When God calls on them to do something great for Him, they have absolutely nothing left to give. They've used up all their ammunition, all their effort, all their strength, shooting at each other, shooting at the saints. Throughout church history, churches have split for some of the absolute dumbest reasons. Some have split over such important issues like how many angels can dance on the head of a pin. In America, we actually have a church that has split because they can't agree over whether it is spelled Emmanuel with an I or Emmanuel with an E. So they can't go to church together. We have churches that split over whether they sit on chairs or pews, and if you get to put your name on the pew in the church. There has to be something of more importance in the church today than what type of furniture we park our duffs on. There has to be. If not, then the church is finished. There was an issue of National Geographic a while back that included a photograph of the fossil remains of two saber-toothed tigers locked in combat. I'll quote the article that said, "One had bitten deep into the leg bone of the other, a thrust that trapped them both in a common fate. The cause of death of these two cats is as clear as the cause of the extinction of their species. They could not survive because they were too busy fighting each other." And the same can be said of the church today. As the Apostle Paul put it, if you keep on biting and devouring each other, watch out, or you will be destroyed by each other. That's from Galatians 5:15. Satan is a master at using controversial issues to distract the church from her true mission in the world. There's a police officer who tells the story of the tactics of a group of thieves. He said, they enter a store as a group. One or two of them separate from the group, and the others start a loud commotion in another section of the store. This grabs the attention of the clerks and the customers. All eyes are turned toward the disturbance, and while that's going on, the accomplices fill their pockets with the merchandise, with the cash, and then they leave before anyone suspects. Hours, sometimes even days later, the victimized merchants realize things are missing and they call the police. But of course, by that point, it's too late. Now, how often is this strategy